So we look now at the Yellow Palm, really interesting poem about the state of Baghdad after the wars. So we have, first and foremost, in the structure, the refrain. The refrain is really interesting here because each one starts with, I made my way down Palestine Street, and it just sounds like it's going to be something quite light and hearty that comes after it. You know, it sounds something like a ditty or something really simple, like a jokey ballad or a jokey poem that's going to follow. But each one is really, really depressing, each ending. So the first one, after he says it, you know, he sees a funeral, and the second one he sees you know, blood splattered walls, and the third one he sees you know, beggars that are in need of him, and then the fourth one he sees, you know, he's got, even the sun is attacking the city, and then the fifth one he sees a missile, and the sixth one he sees a child, and he doesn't really know whether the child is going to you know, take up arms at the end. The ambiguity of that line, how is he going to become some kind of resistance fighter? Is he, you know, kind of going to be hardened and full of hatred for obviously what's happened to his country? So yeah, the refrain is really interesting because it's just set up, it sets us up for thinking one thing and then flips it onto its head. So then we've got the enjambment, and the enjambment obviously invites us to stop and consider, obviously watching and seeing and smelling as this person is walking around. So here we have all the women waving lilac stems, and then he kind of wants, you know, he sees that, and then he wants to see what exactly they're doing around a coffin made of glass, and that's the second thing he notices. And then after that he notices the face of the man. So the enjambment there kind of really takes in stages in his journey. I heard the call to prayer, and I stopped at the door of the golden mosque. You know, so we were taking on it bit by bit, remembering everything as he remembered it. Remembering everything. Sorry, invited to recall everything as he remembers it, which is a really interesting use of enjambment to let us stop and consider. And we've got the rhyme. The rhyme is quite an interesting rhyme scheme. We've got A, B, C, B, DB. So obviously the second line and everything is the one that rhymes, and I haven't really seen it in a poem of six before. So again, it's just kind of got this rhythm going to it, and it feels like it should be more cheery, but again, it isn't in any way. And that obviously adds kind of an ironic tone to the feeling here because of what's happening in the place. You know, it's a beautiful, amazing city, and then it's just, you know, been turned into a rather decrepit place. So the rhyme scheme kind of accentuates that. So we move on to the meanings, and obviously the first meaning we can pick up is on the state of Baghdad, and obviously that can be seen in every single thing. Obviously you can reference, you know, that, you know, people are always in mourning, you know, the people who are supposed to be calling people to calm and you know, to some kind of inner peace within the mosques, are, you know, they're there, you can see in themselves that they're, you know, just full of despair, and they're the ones that need hope and actually picking up. State of Baghdad again, you're looking at the you know, the city so battered that we've got the idea here of even the sun seems like it's taking them for a ride and attacking them, and you know, it never relents, and you know, is always on top of them and making the, you know, pressing down on them. And obviously that could actually be a reference to America as well, in terms of this, the superpower, you know, because America is the only superpower in the world at the moment. And, you know, obviously it's never relenting. But obviously that's changed of very recently with a lot of the troops being sent home. But anyway, you could look at it that way. But actually thinking about it, I would stick more with just the idea of, you know, it being just the sun. But obviously if you think you can take the idea and transpose it on something further, then please do. Second meaning we get is the idea of Baghdad's future, you know, how it's actually going to be, and that really kind of comes through when we actually get the idea of the child, because obviously the child we know is going to grow and obviously going to change. So we've got the idea here of this child, you know, he's smiling even though he's kind of looking at something there. He's looking at the cruise missile, and he's not blessing with a smile in terms of he thinks it's a good thing. It's just kind of like, you know, he brings a blessing to the situation, into this terrible situation with a smile, and that kind of, you know, is he's looking for the silver lining on the cloud rather than him actually saying, yay, another cruise missile. Don't get that mixed up. And then we've also got the idea of the Baghdad's future as well, in the fact that when this is really great last stanza, where the idea of, you know, everything's been planted, because obviously when something's planted, obviously we have something growing out of it. So here we actually have the trees, obviously they're planted, the yellow palms, and you know, they've got their dates, etc. And then the child reaches up, to touch it, and the fruit fell into his arms. And obviously there, on one that you could imagine that's the child actually reaching up to get the fruit, but on the other side of it, it's actually, you know, what is this child going to reap from everything that's actually been put in there, been done to the country? You know, how's he going to feel about it? So it's really interesting, it's looking at Baghdad's future, you know, how the next generation are actually going to deal with this, in a very aggressive or an understanding or a cooperative or a, you know, all those different kind of ways. And obviously you see the ongoing problems in Iraq with the political situation there is obviously very grey still. So yeah, there's lots to actually consider there with regards to Baghdad's future. And one of the other meanings and the ideas behind it obviously is the issues facing the people. You know, everyone here's, you know, got a problem. You know, how are these people going to deal with the loss of what could have been a father or a son, you know, someone they love so much? How is this mad thing going to, you know, refind his faith and actually kind of pull himself up and, you know, be able to help others? How are the beggars, you know, going to be able to see how much things have changed, and that perhaps, you know, the Imperial Guard are no longer in control, so this is, you know, of no reference anymore? How is the how are people going to be avoiding the onslaught of drone missiles and cruise missiles, etc. So there's lots to think about there in terms of the meaning and what ideas and themes are being presented to us. So obviously, you know, we get the theme of loss and of despair and decay, you know, but obviously everything I've kind of mentioned there is tied into it. I'll just add them there: state of Baghdad in decay and the issues facing people, the future. Okay, yeah. So then in images, what type of scenes are presented to help us think about, you know, all these things? Well, you know, we've got this person who's giving us the idea, you know, what they see in the state of Baghdad. You know, this visitor's taking it in, and he's taking it in through all these sensory ideas. So we get a lot of feel from the senses, you know. So first of all, here he watches, and then here he hears, and then here he touches, you know, the hands of the people, and then here he smells, etc., and here he intuits, you know, he's actually seeing, you know, the wildness in the person's eyes. And then the only one I couldn't really get was taste, so I put a really weak link in for taste. I wouldn't use this one, but I'm just using it to reference here. Obviously this person here must have tasted the gas, you know, breathing in, you must taste the gas as he died. So obviously that's my reference to taste. But generally, one of the things in the images of taking everything in, we get a lot of sensory description as well, which is part of the images, you know. So it's a real full and bright picture, and that's coupled as well, I'll just do this one now as well, you know, the couple with the idea of the colors. You know, we've got lots of colors here. We've got lilac, we've got gold, excuse me, we've got black dinars, which is also probably a reference to, you know, maybe money coming from oil, etc. And then we've got the silver caravan, and obviously the yellow palms. So, you know, it's kind of a very bright city. You know, most of those are very, very bright colors that give us the impression of, you know, a lot of life, etc., or a lot of life that should be there. And it just seems weird just being still amidst all this decay and obviously a lot of unhappiness. Another direct image then, we've got the blood on the walls of the sanctuary, the blood on the wall inside the mosque. And I thought that was really good, or I really reckon that's worth analyzing, because there's blood inside the wall, and then obviously inside, so you've got the blood on the wall, and then you've also got the person inside who's obviously got the metaphoric blood in their eyes. So, you know, bloodshot, you know, from being in despair and obviously tired, etc. So you've got blood inside something that's golden. And that's really interesting, because obviously it's talking about, you know, the complete corruption from the inside of something, you know, that was golden. And if you look back in Baghdad's history, you know, it was a golden civilization at one point. It was the epicenter of learning in the world. It's obviously just a far cry from what it was. But obviously that's not just the Americans. The Mongols obviously did that then as well. So you could actually link that to that, you know, you link to the Mongol conquest of Baghdad as well, and maybe there's poetry about the change in the city that you could actually find and reference. But that's an interesting point to actually bring up if the need takes you. Another really interesting image that actually comes through to us is of the missile, the cruise missile, obviously, you know, still kind of falling and still attacking. And obviously that gives us an idea of, again, you know, they're still under this war, they're still being attacked, etc. It's, again, it just kind of ties in with the idea of, you know, that's the state of Baghdad, and, you know, that's how things are for the people, and that's another one of the issues they face. So yeah, it's really strong. And yeah, so those two images we've already done, so we move on now to language. And first off, we have the metaphor of the caravan, a slow and silver caravan, on its slow and silver mile. Really interesting, because obviously historically we kind of tie a lot of ideas of caravans and the moving caravan, the trade caravans, in with like Baghdad and obviously the Middle East, and just a kind of about the souks and the markets, etc. It's just obviously it happens everywhere, but stereotypically here we have the idea of the caravan traveling and doing it. And it's interesting because now that cruise missile is a metaphor for the caravan, but it's also an extent, you could extend that further and actually say, it's to do with, that's the trade here, that's what, money's been made out of this, the cruise missiles and obviously the war, and obviously that's open to interpretation, but I do think from the stance, the rest of the stance of the poem, the writer is alluding to that there. We've got the personification of the sun, that it's a barbarian attacking them, and obviously it knows no armistice, so it will never give up, and it's just always on top of them. We've got the alliteration as well, where we talk about the blind beggars. Sorry, skip me for a while. So we've got the blind beggars here with the, and obviously the alliteration there is actually just used, to compound how sorry the situation is, that they're blind and that they're beggars. Obviously, kind of hits us quite hard with that. And obviously with the language here, we've got lots of references to war. Obviously, we've got the poison gas there. We've got the blood splattered walls. We've got the reference to the Imperial Guard, which was supposed to be defending the place. And we've got the defending Iraq, and we've got the idea of the mother of all wars, which talks about the threats that just how important, how big this war was in terms of I think it was something that Saddam Hussein actually said, that there will be the mother of all wars if you dare try and attack us, etc. And then in both wars, unfortunately, it wasn't really much of a battle, or more than really a battle at all. It was very one-sided, in fact. We've got the barbarians here, the reference again to the war. We've got the armistice, the idea of a peace treaty. And we've got the cruise missile. So again, lots and lots. And I think, again, the most interesting one here, I think I've mentioned it just earlier, is that the idea of the arms here, ending on that last word. We need to know how that's going to end. Is there going to be arms of help or arms of war that the child is actually going to have? So the effect on the reader. Well, things about the effect on war, just in terms of who wins, who loses, but just in terms of who loses a society, society just gets utterly destroyed. And again, you can reference Vietnam and obviously look at the kind of how Vietnam changed so much after the war, back then. Give us an idea of the people that we don't see, obviously the thinking about the people who have faith losing faith, or the people who have faith not being able to help people. Obviously that's quite it's just saddening, just the person that won't be able to do that particular role, when a society is really going to be needing and I can uplift, and that person's not in the right position to do it. But we also think about the psychological effects on everyone, everyone's mind here, how much hatred or how much anger or how much resentment or how much despair or how much pain is everyone going to have. So the stretch there of the psychological effects and the human condition is quite telling.